Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Frogman Stories, Life and Leadership Lessons from the SEAL Teams, by Rick Kaiser, narrated by Rick Kaiser. Acknowledgements. I have countless people to credit for my success and where I am today. Surrounding myself with like-minded people has helped me feed off their energy during good times and bad. The mission is everything, whether it be an actual combat mission or the mission of the National Navy SEAL Museum. Find that mission. Write it down if you must and use it as a guide to your path. Deviate when you have to, but come back on course as soon as possible. Accept help and guidance from others, but ultimately you are the one in control of your destiny. I can't tell you what I would have done all those years ago if I'd either quit or been injured during SEAL training. Dwelling on anything you have no control over is a distraction from the mission. Laser focus is the key. It has served me well. As I look back on my life and career, I realize many of the things that happened to me, good or bad, were out of my control. I just set myself up to be in the best position possible no matter what happened. All in all, it worked out in my favor from my initial boss, Rudy Bosch, to taking the helm of the Navy SEAL Museum. Thank you. To my wife, Barbara, for your love and support at all times. To Emily and Eric for being the best kids any father could hope for. To Helen and Jim for teaching me what is important in life. To Hector and Michelle for teaching me to have fun no matter what. To the Navy SEAL Museum team in Florida and California, and the crew at Naval Special Warfare Development Group for all your selfless hard work in support of others. The U.S. Navy SEAL Ethos. In times of war or uncertainty, there's a special breed of warrior ready to answer our nation's call. A common man with uncommon desire to succeed. Forged by adversity, he stands alongside America's finest special operations forces to serve his country, the American people, and protect their way of life. I am that man. My trident is a symbol of honor and heritage bestowed upon me by the heroes that have gone before. It embodies the trust of those I have sworn to protect. By wearing the trident, I accept the responsibility of my chosen profession and way of life. It is a privilege that I must earn every day. My loyalty to country and team is beyond reproach. I humbly serve as a guardian to my fellow Americans, always ready to defend those who are unable to defend themselves. I do not advertise the nature of my work, nor seek recognition for my actions. I voluntarily accept inherent hazards of my profession, placing the welfare and security of others before my own. I serve with honor on and off the battlefield. The ability to control my emotions and my actions, regardless of circumstances, sets me apart from other men. Uncompromising integrity is my standard. My character and honor are steadfast. My word is my bond. We expect to lead and be led. In the absence of orders, I will take charge, lead my teammates, and accomplish the mission. I lead by example in all situations. I will never quit. I persevere and thrive on adversity. My nation expects me to be physically harder and mentally stronger than my enemies. If knocked down, I'll get back up every time. I'll draw on every remaining ounce of my strength to protect my teammates and to accomplish our mission. I am never out of the fight. We demand discipline. We expect innovation. The lives of my teammates and the success of our mission depend on me, my technical skill, tactical proficiency, and attention to detail. My training is never complete. We train for war and we fight to win. I stand ready to bring the full spectrum of combat power to bear in order to achieve my mission and the goals established by my country. The execution of my duties will be swift and violent when required, yet guided by the very principles that I serve to defend. Brave men have fought and died building the proud tradition and feared reputation that I am bound to uphold. In the worst conditions, the legacy of my teammates steadies my resolve and silently guides my every deed. I will not fail. Chapter 1, Prologue. Not all leaders are born. As in my case, years of being raised correctly and then a lifetime in the U.S. Navy have honed my abilities and taught me how to lead. No one can go to where they want to be without conflict along the way. Whether it be personal relationships or actual fighting on the battlefield, everyone has scars, which hopefully remind us of how we got here in the first place. It is how you use those scars that make you an effective leader. Leading is not a popularity contest. If you hope to make friends and influence others, forget it. You may as well stay in bed. No need to make it. No one who makes the hard calls is loved by all. That is a falsity from other books and war movies. I've thought about writing this book for some time now. I'm not sure why this is the time. As in all things in life, if you don't try, nothing is going to change. I've been fortunate to be led by some of the greatest warriors on the planet. I have also been unfortunate to be led by some of the worst examples of incompetence known to man. Greatly, I've had far more great leaders than not. My only advice is to hang on and survive during the bad times. If you are expecting a tell-all book about Navy SEALs, forget it. Give the book away to someone else. This is simply my attempt to portray the teams like they really are through humor and a few choice tidbits of knowledge earned the hard way. I'm sure not all will see the humor in my stories, but that is okay. Like I am known to say around the workplace, they can kiss my ass. Get a sense of humor and stop taking yourself so seriously. Put down the phone, sign off of MySpace, that's just a joke, and do something productive. I was born and raised in a small town named Oak Creek, Wisconsin, on the south side of Milwaukee. My parents, Elmer and Laverne Kaiser, raised me along with two brothers and two sisters in a small three-bedroom, one-bath home. I didn't think about it that much at the time, but it is amazing how seven people lived and got along with one bathroom. My mother was a saint. She managed to run her household, lead five children and a husband on a very modest salary my father earned as a local firefighter. She is one who taught me from the start that you don't have to be the loudest person in the room to accomplish your goals. Subtlety is an art learned over time. Picking your battles is another. Not all issues are worth falling on your sword. I've witnessed many leaders create chaos over every issue only to have the truly important problems glossed over or ignored altogether. My mother was soft-spoken, but got her point across through love and understanding. Letting her down was one of my greatest fears growing up, not because I would receive a beating, just the thought of disappointing her would crush my soul. A person who is that good is loved and respected by all who know them. I know I could never be that person, nor do I want to be. However, her teachings throughout my life have served me well. In fact, every time I have lost my temper or acted out of anger, I have regretted my actions because in the end, I lost credibility and made poor choices. Taking a deep breath, waiting 24 hours, and talking to others will always serve you better than yelling or brute force. Remember I said, try to do the right thing. Unfortunately, while growing up, I suffered from BSU disease, big, slow, and uncoordinated. Fortunately, this ended up helping me immensely in the long run. I tried to be a jock, but never quite had the skills to succeed at a high level in any sports. My brothers had better luck, but it was my two sisters who were the real athletes in the family, Sorry Mike and Bob, and well known in the state of Wisconsin on the volleyball and basketball courts. Me, on the other hand, not so much. I tried out for the basketball team in my freshman year of high school because it was what all my friends were doing. When I look back on it now, I think I was cut after exiting the locker room on the way to the court. Never one to quit, I decided to try out for the swim team. At the time, I knew how to doggy paddle and not drown. That was about it. Why I wanted to join the swim team is still a mystery to me. The coach decided to give me a chance and put me in the diving well away from the team so I could learn how to swim properly with some guidance. I know that sort of thing doesn't happen anymore when trying out for high school sports, but it worked out for me. Not only was I winning races by the time I was a senior, but the swimming skills and confidence I learned in the water have served me well from basic underwater demolition SEAL training to the present. Never quit. I'd always had a fascination with the ocean as a kid due to the show The Undersea World of Jacques Cousteau. I liked the water and swimming, which my high school swimming career had solidified in my mind. At the time, I believed the U.S. Navy submarine service was the right choice for me. That changed after my first trip to the Navy recruiter's office in South Milwaukee, Wisconsin. Lo and behold, on his desk was a marketing pamphlet for Navy SEALs titled The Men with Green Faces. I picked it up and started looking at the pictures. I thought to myself, this is badass. This is what I want to do. SEAL equals sea, air, land. Dive, jump, shoot, my dream come true. I was clueless. I asked the recruiter if I could take the pamphlet home. He didn't care because if it got him another number for his quota, he was all for it. He didn't know what a SEAL was either. After contemplating the pamphlet for 48 hours, I decided I was going to pull the trigger and sign up to be a Navy SEAL. The recruiter was happy until he realized I had to pass the Navy's initial entrance exam at a higher level than the average sailor, and there was a physical screening test involved. I was a good student and didn't have any problem with the written test. The physical testing would be a bit different. I knew I could pass the standard. I made an appointment with my mother. I was 17 at the time, to visit Great Lakes Recruit Training Command and take the test with a real Navy SEAL running it. We drove down to Chicago on a Friday evening in the middle of winter in the Midwest. It was cold and snowing. The first portion of the test was inside at the pool along with the pull-ups, push-ups, and sit-ups. The run, however, was outside on the track next to the pool. A little whining here, the track was covered with snow. The temperature was easily below zero with wind chill, and I was wet with sweat and pool water. My first Navy SEAL test. I made the run under time and passed the physical screening test. The SEAL never came outside. That should have told me something. The fact that I was 17 at the time and wanted to join the Navy caused a bit of uproar at the Kaiser household. Because I was 17, it meant one of my parents had to sign the paperwork for me to enlist. Neither mom nor dad was in a big hurry to sign the papers. I guess they had fresh memories of Vietnam on their minds that I wasn't tracking at all. What high school kid was? Eventually, one of them signed the paperwork. I am grateful to them both for the trust they put in me. Chapter 2. Hold the Standard. I graduated basic underwater demolition SEAL training, BUDS, at the age of 18 as part of Class 109 in the summer of 1980. Soon thereafter, I reported for duty at SEAL Team 2 in Little Creek, Virginia. Command Master Chief Rudy Bosch was the senior enlisted man on board and trusted advisor to the commanding officer. Rudy was in charge of managing a team of nearly 100 Navy SEALs and other support personnel. He had already been in the U.S. Navy for 30 years when I arrived at SEAL Team 2. In fact, Rudy had been a Master Chief, the highest rank in the Navy, for longer than I had been alive. When the Japanese attacked Pearl Harbor on December 7, 1941, Navy Frogman did not exist. The term Frogman refers to all units, past and present, of Naval Special Warfare. Naval Combat Demolition Units, NCDU, Underwater Demolition Teams, UDT, Scouts and Raiders, SNR, OSS Maritime Swimmers, Office of Strategic Services, precursor to the CIA, and present-day U.S. Navy SEAL teams, but did not come into being until after the Korean War. I am sure all our predecessors are proud to use the name. The Navy needed tough men skilled in all types of warfare to carry out some of the most difficult and dangerous missions of World War II. Their primary mission, reconnoiter enemy-held beaches and destroy obstacles, man-made and natural, that would slow down landing craft during amphibious landings. In 1942, there were no tactics, techniques, or procedures to accomplish this mission. The frogmen had to develop the skills necessary on their own with limited experience of a few leaders such as Lieutenant Draper Kaufman, who was at the time one of the few explosive experts in the Navy. Explosives are a tool of choice for all Navy SEALs. One of my many mottos growing up through the teams was, when in doubt, overload. If you're not sure whether the explosives you brought will do the job, add more. One of the men who volunteered for this hazardous duty and completed SNR training during World War II was Rudy Bosch. Imagine joining the Navy during the war, volunteering for Scouts and Raider training, getting on a train in Norfolk, Virginia, and traveling to Fort Pierce, Florida, the birthplace of Naval Special Warfare, only to immediately start Hell Week upon arrival. There was no time for hand-holding. They had to be trained to fight both the Germans and the Japanese as fast as possible. Within 12 months, the original Frogman had to adapt to and overcome a type of warfare that had not existed before that time. Scouts and Raiders were assigned missions similar to what Navy SEALs do today: attack from the sea, recon enemy-held territory, and take out critical infrastructure such as bridges and railroad tracks. Unconventional warfare. As with all wars, the United States has a tendency to downsize immediately following the conflict. World War II is no exception, and the entire unit of Scouts and Raiders was disbanded. Rudy then volunteered for the famed underwater demolition teams who fought in the Pacific on what was an island-hopping strategy on the way to Japan. Rudy remained a UDT member through the Korean War and many other unnamed or unacknowledged conflicts until 1962, when President John F. Kennedy signed the official paperwork which created the first two SEAL teams: SEAL Team 1, based in Coronado, California, and SEAL Team 2, based in Little Creek, Virginia. Rudy was a plank owner, original member of the legendary SEAL Team 2. The SEAL teams, or sea, air, land teams, were created to fight in the deltas and rivers of Vietnam. As with his forefathers of the NCDUs, UDTs, and SNR, there was no playbook for the Navy SEALs. They had to create it, and they were successful. Like their predecessors from World War II, many of the tactics and techniques that the original SEALs created were still being used in the caves of Afghanistan to the deserts of Iraq. Junior enlisted men, such as I, don't spend a lot of time with the CMC unless there's a specific reason, usually discipline. Luckily, I kept my nose relatively clean and avoided Rudy's gaze. When I had the chance to finally meet the man, I was understandably nervous. Here was a World War II, Korea, and Vietnam SEAL who had been there and done that for decades. What could he possibly want with me? I walked into the office, stood at attention, and waited for the secrets of being a SEAL. What he said instead was, "Kaiser, keep your uniform squared away and your hair cut. Come see me in 6 months and I'll decide if you get your trident or not." What? Does he not understand I just completed SEAL training? Shouldn't he be telling me war stories? How could I be a badass SEAL like he is? Well, that is all I got, but honestly, it was some of the best guidance I ever received in the teams. What I didn't understand at the time was what that one sentence actually meant: maintain the standard or face the consequences. SEALs have a way of pushing or testing the rules which is hammered into your soul, starting with BUDS training. The instructors want two things from every candidate: quit in training, not in combat, and figure out a way to do every mission, never quit. Rules about haircuts and uniforms mean little when you believe you can accomplish anything, no matter what the task. What Rudy did with the early guidance was lay down the law and set a standard. Do these two simple tasks and you will prove that you are responsible for more. There is no gray area when it comes to a squared away uniform or haircut. No room for interpretation. Yes, no, black and white, in a world that is anything but. Hold a standard. When I received this brief guidance from Rudy, I said, "Yes, Master Chief," and left the office. Although a bit disappointed, I had not learned how to take out a sentry with a ballpoint pen. At least I wasn't in trouble. SEALs have a tendency to get into trouble at times. It's in our DNA. The trick was to keep it to a minimum and never do anything to dishonor the team. The absolute task that no SEAL or any person on this planet would enjoy is a duty called standing quarterdeck watch. In a SEAL team, that means answering the phone and greeting people at the front door in a proper uniform and with a good haircut. If you were lucky at SEAL Team 2, you would only have to stand duty for 24 hours every few weeks. Not too bad in the big picture, but I was a Navy SEAL. I didn't have time for that. My goals at the time were to go out on the town as often as I could and have as much fun as I could handle, like all 18-year-olds. What I didn't realize when he was laying down the order was how swift and effective the consequences and/or punishments were. All it took was one glance from Rudy with a follow-up statement, "Seal X. Go get a haircut and report to the quarterdeck." Nobody ever questioned or complained about the order. We knew when we were wrong, and accepting the punishment was part of the price. If you were a habitual offender, Rudy would think of other duties even more painful to help you find your way. Raking the leaves from the entire SEAL Team 2 compound, cleaning all the heads, bathrooms, in the building, or worst of all, confinement to the team for an extended period. Rudy's orders served me well over my career. I made it a point to always have a good haircut and squared away uniform. Two simple things I didn't have to worry about. I remember a time in Bosnia in late 1990s when our mission was to hunt persons indicted for war crimes. When having long hair was approved for our team in order to fit in with the local population. I thought it was going to be cool to have long hair, but it did not last 3 weeks before I was in the barber asking for a trim. I thought of myself as a Bosnian businessman rather than the Bosnian biker thugs all my teammates looked like. I picked Hold a Standard as a theme to this book and my leadership style because it'll work for any age from millennial to boomer. Everyone has probably heard this before in a different manner. It is always easier to loosen up than tighten up when it comes to discipline. Hold a Standard is the starting point. Rudy always led from the front. He was always taking part in every physical fitness event the team had going each morning, whether it be an ocean swim in freezing water or multiple obstacle courses, followed by a long run, Rudy was there. Never first, but also never last. As a young guy, I was impressed and hoped to be able to do the same thing as I got older. Chapter 3. There are two ways to do things, the right way and again. Basic underwater demolition SEAL BUDS training is the initial six-month training pipeline that defines being a Navy SEAL. The easiest way to spot a fake SEAL is to ask what his BUDS class number was. If he doesn't automatically come out with a number that makes sense or says it's classified, he is a fraud. When I went to BUDS, I did not understand any of the history or heritage of Naval Special Warfare. Sad but true, NSW does a very poor job educating young frogmen about the past. Many of the traditions carried out over 80 years ago in Fort Pierce are still done today. A typical BUDS class to this day can be seen carrying rubber boats called IBS, or inflatable boat small, in Navy speak. For years, I believed it was just the BUDS instructor's way of torturing prospective SEALs. Little did I know the frogmen of World War II that infiltrated the beaches of Normandy paddled in those rubber boats full of explosives so they could destroy the German obstacles which lined the beaches. The boats were part of their life and critical to their mission. Other traditions started in Fort Pierce, such as training of officers and enlisted men, log PT, and Hell Week. Log PT is simply that, physical training using a large log. Usually a group of seven men would have to lift the log and work as a team in order to move the log in whatever manner the instructor wanted. Hell Week was also started in Fort Pierce and was used as a way to test men to perform their duties with little sleep while under constant pressure. I think it would have been helpful to know the reasons why we were doing certain activities. It would have given us a tie or bond to the frogmen of the past. History and heritage must never be forgotten. They help us remember our beginnings and realize we are not special. Many men have fought and died through the years with a lot less recognition, training, and equipment than any of the current SEALs will ever know. Every SEAL thinks their BUDS class was the hardest ever. Every SEAL thinks they are the best SEAL, or at least they should. If not, you may as well go home because you don't belong. Seems rough, but without that way of thinking, it will be impossible to lead. I didn't believe I was the best SEAL while going through BUDS training. I was a fair athlete, I could run, I could swim, and I was fairly mentally tough. My two sisters were the real athletes in my family. My two brothers and I had to take a back seat to their accomplishments. I fully acknowledge their achievements, but it still tends to become a joke when we get together and talk about high school, especially after I completed Bud's. Bud's training, for the most part, is a mental and physical grind. If you can survive the day-to-day routine of pain and cold, you can complete Bud's. My weakness was, and always will be, push-ups. Long arms, not built for explosive strength, more a distance athlete. Of course, push-ups were a daily torture I dreaded at Bud's. Never-ending push-ups were always on my mind. It was easy for the instructors to see who was struggling and who wasn't. I was punished immensely through Bud's for my lack of push-up skill. The pain even started before Bud's officially did. Class 109 was to start on a Monday. Part of the tradition of Bud's was for the prospective class of over 150 guys to shave their heads to prepare for the first day of training. Hair only gets in the way during training. As we were drinking and celebrating our new lives, a few individuals thought it would be a good idea to grab a random sailor from the beach where we were shaving our heads and also shave his head. Bad idea. The poor guy never had a chance. No one listened to his screams of terror. Many didn't even know he wasn't even going through Bud's. The incident lasted no longer than 5 minutes and the sailor was gone, never to be seen again. Or so we thought. The next morning, we all got in formation and waited for our instructors to begin. As we stood in the front of the barracks for over an hour, we started to wonder what was going on. Our answers came very quickly in the form of the commanding officer, CO, of Bud's training. He proceeded to drop us in the push-up position and begin a lecture on why we had made a tremendous mistake shaving the head of a random sailor the day before. As it turns out, the sailor was a junior officer going to fleet training in Coronado Amphibious Base. He was not happy, his commanding officer was not happy, and our CO was pissed. We stayed in the push-up position for over an hour until our noodle arms could take no more. Then we all lined up so the shaved officer could walk by each and every one of us so he could identify the culprits that shaved his head. To this day, I'm not sure if the officer really didn't recognize the guys that shaved his head or if he had made a deal with the CO to scare us. Either way, he walked by each of us and left. We had sufficient rest at that point to be dropped once again for another hour until training officially began. This was going to be hell. I hate push-ups. A typical Bud's class was around 70% or higher attrition rate. Class 109 was no different. We started with approximately 150 men and finished with 30. What I finally figured out after living through the first month of Bud's training was, just like the getting a haircut analogy, the instructors had black and white rules to guide their actions. Number one, they can't kill you. Sure, they can make you suffer, but not to the point of physical harm. Number two, no matter how bad it gets, they can't take your birthday away, and your mother will still love you, regardless of the outcome of SEAL training. Number three, they will not let you get out of the cold water until the medical guidelines of hypothermia are met. In other words, taking into account your body weight and water temperature, a human can survive a specified amount of time in cold water. Cut and dried, tried and true numbers monitored by medical professionals. The hypothermia guideline states if the water temperature is between 50 to 60 degrees, an individual can last 1 to 2 hours before exhaustion or unconsciousness. The first time my class of SEAL candidates was put in the 60-degree Pacific Ocean, we had no clue about the hypothermia charts. All we knew was the water was cold and no one was going to quit. 30 minutes later, the instructors offered the class a deal. If someone quit, we could all get out of the water. At that point, no one was shaking to the point of quitting. 30 more minutes into the evolution, however, the first hand went up and the classmate was escorted from the water, never to be seen again. Thinking we were all getting out of the water at any minute, the instructors made another deal. First, since the individual quit 30 minutes after the first deal, it was invalid. Second, if we wanted to get out of the water, it would take two people quitting. The next two people inevitably quit, but the stakes kept getting higher. By the time we actually got out of the water...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.